The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hello and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. I'd like to welcome back to the Fort Report Cathie Humbarger, Executive Director of Allen County Right to Life. Cathie.
So glad to be with you,
good
Kevin.
Good to see you. I thought it was a good time to have Cathie back on. This is the first time in my memory we could say Fort Wayne has had no legal abortion clinic and now recently no Planned Parenthood office, which I know you're very pleased about both.
I am.
So we will talk about both of those in more detail. Before we do, why don't we start with the item that's been in the national news all week, which is we have a new Supreme Court nominee, Brett Kavanaugh. And of course, immediately the speculation was, if he's confirmed, we're going to have a repeal of Roe versus Wade. So tell me what you think of him, first of all, and then is the repeal of Roe versus Wade a goal of yours, and do you think it is something that could actually happen?
Well, I will answer the middle question first. It is always a goal of ours to see Roe overturned. Whether that happens in the near future is debatable, but that is certainly our goal. If I'd had the choice, I probably would have picked our own Indiana native justice, the justice that was the South Bend.
Right. Sounds like she's next in line.
I hope so. Amy Barrett, right. Her name escaped me for a moment, but she would have been my first choice. I know there were other factors that were influencing the president as he made his choice, and he certainly makes independent choices. There's no doubt about that. Whether the justice that was named the nominee will prove to be a significant factor in overturning Roe remains to be seen. I think what's more likely to happen, Kevin, is that the cases that are bubbling up through the court system now have more to do with challenging the Casey decision, which had to do with the states being able to restrict abortion. So I would see that being the route that is going to unfold under this new Supreme Court.
Now, he's a Catholic. You can't always infer all Catholics are pro-life, but I'm pretty sure he is.
Well, I could give you a list of those whose actions probably
Trump
don't support.
Trump did say he was going to appoint pro-life judges, so I mean, we take him at his word on that.
Well, he had a list of 25. I think he may have added a couple of names to that since the election, but there were no surprises.
Now, we will go through the charade, though, of liberals in Congress asking him what he would do about Roe versus Wade.
Indeed.
And he will say,
I can't comment on that. I have to see the case that I will remain open-minded.
Right, which is kind of the game they play
Indeed.
These days. But well, let me ask you this. You mentioned the cases now pending aren't specifically intended to target Roe.
Right.
But should you have a more solid conservative majority, I'm guessing that will change eventually. There will be a test case, don't you think?
Well, there are several that are in the lower courts right now. One was passed right here in Indiana a couple of sessions ago, which made abortion illegal if the decision to abort the child impacted a baby that fell within the protected classes named under the anti-discrimination laws. That would be disability, race, gender, any of those things. If those were the sole reason, any one of those reasons for an abortion, the abortion would be illegal. Now, what's interesting about the law that was passed here in Indiana, Kevin, is that the law was in the anti-discrimination part of the code. It was not in the abortion code. So the judges, the justices that review this are going to have to determine what's more important, the discrimination foundational that we issue that we stand on, or a free and unfettered access to abortion.
Well, that is kind of an interesting modern dilemma.
It is.
We would consider discrimination more serious than what you or I might consider.
Exactly.
Homicide.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And speaking of homicide, that brings up another law that was passed in this past, just this past session, and that would enable a criminal to be charged for homicide if, in the act of committing his crime, the pregnant mother's unborn child was killed or injured. Mm-hmm. So if a criminal kills the baby during a criminal act, the criminal can be charged for homicide. But if the same child is killed by an abortionist, mm-hmm. it's perfectly legal. So there is a dichotomy and some reconciliation that needs to happen.
The humanity all depends on whether the mother thinks it is. But now let's go back to Roe.
If
you do succeed in overturning it, mm-hmm. you know, abortion doesn't go away. I mean, it'll go back as it was prior to 1973.
Right, back to the states.
It'll be a state issue. What then?
Well, interesting to know that some of the states never did repeal their abortion laws. So if Roe were overturned, those laws would be in effect. Other states have passed legislation since Roe that says something to the effect that if Roe is ever overturned, abortion will immediately become illegal in their state. And then other states, of course, would be perfectly willing to have abortions continue and even increase in their state. So it's going to be an interesting, you're right, it will not be over. The fight will be over when, like any other egregious social issue, the hearts and minds of individual Americans recognize the horror for what it is. I personally don't care if Roe's ever overturned, although that's a goal of ours, and here's the reason why. If abortion becomes unthinkable and there's no market for abortion, Roe can stand forever, but babies aren't being killed.
Well, as a strictly constitutional matter, take the morality out of it.
Mm-hmm. I'll try.
I think at the state level is where it belongs.
Right.
But, I mean, if I'm a right to life director, I'm going to want to fight in every state.
And we will. We will. We're not going away.
Do you think it, and again, it would be an ironic thing to expect a conservative Supreme Court to do the opposite of what the liberal court did and outlaw abortion. Would you be okay with that?
If the Supreme Court outlawed abortion?
On a national level.
We would be okay with that.
But you wouldn't have a constitutional issue with that?
Depending on where it was found, on what basis. And it may be found on the fact that there's just nothing in the Constitution that supports legalized abortion.
Right. But you're right. I mean, and this is the irony of the fight that you've been waging all these years. I did a little research, and I think the rate of abortion is now...
You're an old-time reporter if you did some research.
Yeah, well, the abortion rate is at the lowest it's been since Roe was passed, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that, I think, is not largely a matter of the law. It's a matter of, as you say,
winning hearts and minds. One of the biggest tools in the pro-life toolbox are ultrasounds. I think if you go back and read the original decision, there was some mushy language about not really knowing what if the unborn was human or not, or a potential life or not. But a lot has been learned since 1973 about the science of a developing embryo. And there is absolutely no doubt, I mean, the baby's heart starts beating at 21 days, and that's roughly 21 days, and that's before a mother even knows that she's carrying a child. So a lot of those medical facts have been learned since 1973, and then ultrasound has just made an amazing difference. There's no better witness for the unborn, Kevin, than the unborn.
And often the ultrasound is mandated by law, so they kind of go together at times.
Well, typically the way the law reads is that the mother has to have the opportunity to see the ultrasound. I don't think anybody's running around, you know, sticking the screen in her face if she chooses not to, but here in Indiana, she merely needs to sign a form saying, yes, I did, in fact, you have the opportunity to see an ultrasound. Now, the fight on ultrasound here in Indiana has to do with when the ultrasound is shown. We passed a legislation a number of years ago that required abortion providers to explain to the woman what the procedure was all about, what the complications might be, etc. Since then, the law was added to the law was the opportunity for the mother to see the ultrasound. And that was okay, too, with the abortion providers until the law was changed again to say that at the time of her 18-hour notification, which by law the woman has to receive all the information about the abortion at least 18 hours before the abortion, that's when the mother has the opportunity to see the ultrasound. The abortionist was perfectly fine showing her the ultrasound while she was laying on the table minutes before the procedure, but not so much with showing it to her when she has ample time to think about the decision after she's seen the child. Additionally, it's more cost to the abortion providers, particularly Planned Parenthood, because they then have, if they want to give the notification in all of their satellite offices, even the ones that don't provide abortions, they have to have an ultrasound machine and a tech at that location, and that was beyond what they were willing to do. So they're fighting that in court as well.
Well, you mentioned Planned Parenthood, so why don't we segue into that. This past week, the office that had been here a long time closed.
Much to my surprise, I didn't see that coming.
Well, is that right? Because, I mean, I wrote about it after talking with you a year ago that they had lost their lease and were on a month-to-month basis.
I didn't see it coming now. I would have, if you'd asked me last August when we talked about this before, I would have thought it would have happened within days or weeks. But as time drug on, I thought...
I was wondering what had happened to all that.
So when I say that I was surprised, I was, because I thought... that it had been resolved somehow between the property owner and Planned Parenthood, and they were going to stay there.
Now, you made no secret of the fact last August that you had talked, or your organization had talked with other realtors, hoping that they would not find an alternate location for Planned Parenthood.
Mm-hmm, indeed.
But I mean, I know Planned Parenthood this week said it went beyond that there was intimidation and harassment of their individual employees or whatever. And I know you issued a statement, but I think by now you've had a chance to look into it a little bit more. Was any kind of intimidation or harassment by any of your people that you're aware of related to this? And whether it was or not, what is your own personal feeling about the legitimacy of that kind of tactic?
Well, you know, I find it kind of amusing. I'm grandmother to 14, and our little Allen County Right to Life affiliate here is intimidating and harassing a business that, according to their last annual report, generated over $18 million in revenue. I find it a little bit hard to believe that, you know, a little old grandmother and a county organization can do anything that would intimidate and harass a multi-million dollar business. But that's what they're alleging, and I think they did reach back to August as the information has come out, and I didn't know anything about it until I started getting reports or calls from reporters on Monday morning. I think they did reach back into some of the postings and whatnot from last August. And that's what they're basing their.
But if any of their people were contacted at home, or
we had nothing to do with that,
would that be inappropriate, do you think?
I do, absolutely.
I do find it ironic. In fact, I wrote about it today as we tape that. Now you have the left screaming about you know, getting in their face in off hours when it was only the Trump people getting harassed at a restaurant, it was okay.
It was okay, you're exactly right.
Now that the Planned Parenthood thing came out, the Journal Gazette today editorialized much as I did, but only after their side got gored.
Right, exactly. You know, it's kind of ironic, the timing of all of this, because this weekend, as we tape, a couple of days before the weekend, we are hosting, I think it's our 16th annual Life Defenders event for students, high school and college students, to come and learn how to graciously defend the life issue. We help them understand that not everybody believes the Bible, not everybody's Christian, but this issue can certainly be defended based on science and philosophical arguments. And one of the things that we stress is be gracious and kind. If the person that you're discussing this with is angry, you've already lost the debate. So it's interesting that we're being accused of harassment and intimidation the very week that we are planning this event to help students understand how to make the case exactly the opposite of harassment and intimidation.
Do you think, though, and I was back in August a little troubled by the effort to deny them a place to do business. I mean, I don't like Planned Parenthood, but they're legal. If someone wants to lease them a space, that's kind of a private market decision.
It is.
Now, you're obviously able to persuade that, as the left has done with boycotts and everything, but I think there's almost a benefit to your side if you have a foil. I mean, the people out on the sidewalk protesting, where do they go now to make their point?
Oh, believe me, our work is not done. Our work is not done, and we won't quit. And a lot of the good things that have happened here in Allen County are being shared in other parts of the state, and actually, in other states. So, I don't see our work here as being done by any way, shape, or form. And I guess I would take issue with your assertion that we were denying them a place to operate. The only thing we did was let our supporters know that there may be a realtor who was assisting Planned Parenthood in finding another location, and they may want to find out. Mm-hmm. So I don't see how. I think it's a little bit of a leap from
there.
Yeah,
you're not denying them. You're using your influence, which is your right as Americans.
Indeed. I think I would be disappointed if I was a supporter of an organization that knew that the reason that I'm supporting them, that there's something going on, and I wasn't made aware of it.
Now, they are claiming they're going to be back, though.
They are. They were very careful to say in the area, when pressed, they backed off from Fort Wayne and Allen County and said in the area. So I thought that was interesting.
Now, your relationship is inherently going to be one of tension.
Indeed.
But has that been exacerbated, do you think, by all of this, or irrelevant to the debate?
I think it's irrelevant to the debate. I think those issues on which we disagree passionately. It is always our hope, which is another reason for educating the students, that we can present logical information to anyone, even if they're firmly in the pro-abortion camp, that will encourage them to change their minds. And I would be glad if any Planned Parenthood employees have lost employment, I'd be glad to help them find employment with another life-affirming medical provider here in Fort Wayne. We'd be glad to do that. So it's not about the people. We don't hate the people. We don't want to, I don't even want to say what we don't want to do, because somebody might pick that out and say, she said, but we don't wish them ill. We just wish them to change their minds.
Now, Planned Parenthood did not do abortions in Fort Wayne, although they are, I think, still the nation's largest abortion
and
provider.
And Indiana's largest abortion provider.
But they always say, and to a point, I think, accurately, they do other things that are beneficial. Mm-hmm. So what about the argument without them here? Women may be denied a service that they need.
You know, that really made me sad, Kevin, because as I heard that argument come out, I'm thinking, what about all the other very, very well-qualified healthcare providers in Fort Wayne and Allen County? Is Planned Parenthood really trying to make the argument that there's no one else in Fort Wayne and Allen County that can provide the same services? I think that is a straw man argument. I know of other freestanding healthcare clinics that offer much more than Planned Parenthood does, where people can go to get their reproductive health services and additional health services. Additionally, every woman who is on Medicaid, or any person that's on Medicaid in the state of Indiana, has a primary medical provider, a doctor that is tied to their Medicaid services. So that doctor can provide much more than Planned Parenthood can. So I think that's really a very sad argument for Planned Parenthood to make. And I think that would offend the medical providers here in
Allen
County.
So we're talking Neighborhood Health Clinic, Matthew 25.
Right.
Maybe some others.
Right.
Well, why don't we move on briefly from Planned Parenthood.
Okay.
There are other things going on in your world. Baby boxes.
Mm-hmm.
They've been around now for a while. Monica Kelsey from Woodburn is
good friend of mine.
The inventor of this particular device, who grew up in much that same condition when she was a
baby. Her mother abandoned her in the hospital right after her birth, yes.
So this is very personal for her.
It is.
And now in outside of Indianapolis, we have now had the third placed in Indiana. Mm-hmm. And even before that, a baby was dropped off at the fire station down there.
Indeed.
So the word is getting out. Mm-hmm. And maybe for people who don't know about what a baby box is and why I'm guessing you think we could use more of them, give us the Reader's Digest version.
Okay, well, obviously, we always want to make certain that a woman in a crisis situation has the very best care for not only her child, but herself. So our first choice is not for a mother of a newborn to put that baby in a baby box. That is the last resort. But what's interesting, Kevin, is that affiliated with the whole Safe Haven project is a hotline that is staffed 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, that a woman or a parent can call and ask for information about the Safe Haven baby box project and locations, et cetera, here in Indiana. Many times, much more frequently than leaving a baby in a baby box, that woman, mother, is diverted to either a pregnancy care center or a medical provider, depending on her circumstances. There have been numerous documented adoptions that have occurred when the mother has released the baby face-to-face. But at the end of all of that, there were still babies being found in trash cans, in snowbanks, and left out in the searing heat in the summer, and all kinds of incredibly egregious and heartbreaking situations. So if at the very last resort, the only thing that mother can do is place her baby in a safe place, that's what we want to
Well, and
give her
as
the
you mentioned, we do have the safe havens. You can leave them at a hospital or a fire station
already. Right, but there's no anonymity there.
Well, that was my point, that you think this may...
Well, indeed it has in three occasions and since last November, I think, was the first one.
So why, you know, there are still people who claim, and I don't have any reason to doubt them, are pro-life, who don't like baby boxes.
I've never quite understood it. I think it has something to do with the fact that they think that people are going to be chucking babies in baby boxes to hide child abuse and all kinds of things. Or they're going to put dead babies in the baby box to avoid prosecution. But I think if we save one baby, and we've already seen three, it is worth any of those possibilities happening.
Now, these cost roughly how much, do you know?
I really don't know. I think a couple $1,000, maybe, I'm not sure. But in the instances where the babies have been left in the baby boxes, they've been retrieved in well under 5 minutes.
And we should mention they are, I believe, heated or
heated,
cooled,
right, and I think there are three.
They have an alarm.
There are three alarms, one when the box is opened and one when there's weight placed in the on the mattress. And then I think the mother, for her own self-assurance, can press an alarm. So... so far, it has been a stunning success.
Apparently, Fort Wayne has no plan to implement these, though?
Well, I wouldn't say that. That would be a good question for Monica. I'm kind of on the periphery of that. I helped her with the legislation as it went through the State House to make these. It was more of a liability issue for the people that were in a position of accepting the baby. That was the legality that had to be worked out. But there is a baby box here in Allen County at the Woodburn Fire Station. And Allen County Right to Life is currently posting billboards around the area.
Right.
Because we've learned in other places that is one way that the mothers know where to go and the hotline number.
Well, we only have 3 or 4 minutes left. The time has gone quickly.
It does, as it always does when we chat.
So... next year during the legislation session, any bills you're contemplating that might come up?
Well, we're beginning to discuss some possibilities. Of course, with the change in the Supreme Court, that gives us a little bit different view on what might stand up to court challenge. But the important thing to remember is you have to get to the Supreme Court first, and there's some adverse judges along the way that you have to get past in order to get there. So we're beginning to look at legislation. Indiana is certainly a leader in the country on all sorts of regulations, and we plan to continue working our strategy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any of them going to particularly target Roe, do you think?
Well, we already have one in the system, the discrimination. Mm-hmm. And there are several others that are being challenged from more of a regulatory perspective. So we'll see. We will be in discussions with our pro-life legislators commencing fairly quickly to see what is of interest to the legislators and some of the issues that we can bring to the table. And we'll have those discussions and be promoting the legislation that is going to be introduced a little bit later in the year.
Well, we've been now without an abortion clinic in Fort Wayne. How long?
December
of
2013.
Oh, longer than I even remembered.
The last abortion was then in December of 2013.
In a large part because of the bill that required a backup doctor.
Indeed. Yes, that we had an ordinance here in Allen County that actually was on the cutting edge of that. It was even before the state law was passed. So, yes.
Do you think we'll ever see a clinic, either that one or another, reopen in
Allen
County?
Would it be appropriate to say over my dead body?
Well, don't give people any more ammunition.
Okay, right? All right, I won't. I will work hard to make certain that doesn't happen.
Okay. Well, I'm sure you will, and we'll have you back and talk about that, when the time comes.
Thanks, Kevin.
Assuming your dead body is not.
Yeah, well.
Anyway, Cathie, thank you very much for joining us.
You bet.
Appreciate it. And thank all of you for joining us on the Fort Report. Be sure to check this and other episodes out at www.news-sentinel.com. Thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Good.
I hope you got